When the NCAA kicked off an investigation of Michigan State on Tuesday, it opened itself up to a brand of controversy not seen since the Jerry Sandusky scandal at Penn State several years ago, with similar potential pitfalls but also a chance to reaffirm its relevance. At issue is whether the NCAA, an organization whose stated mission is largely to enforce ideals specific to college sports such as competitive balance and amateurism, has the wherewithal and heft to manage a complex investigation outside its expertise while juggling several other inquiries at the same time. The Michigan State case and the Sandusky scandal that started in 2011 share horrific subject matter, the sexual assault of minors. Sandusky, a longtime assistant football coach, was convicted of abusing 10 boys, and it ultimately resulted in several top university officials, including a president and athletic director, serving prison time for their roles in covering up the crimes. At Michigan State, Dr. Lawrence G. Nassar has been sentenced to more than 100 years in prison, with more than 150 female athletes and family members giving statements before Dr. Nassar in court during the past week. It is unclear how many university officials were aware of accusations against him, although the school's president, Lou Anna K. Simon, resigned late Wednesday under pressure from lawmakers and others. The NCAA could emerge from its investigation into Michigan State in a far stronger position than it did following the Penn State case, in which it was widely criticized for overreach and grandstanding, because some of Dr. Nassar's crimes involved student athletes. The NCAA's punishment of Penn State came outside the typical enforcement process. They were the result of a settlement between the NCAA's leadership and the university concerning behavior that arguably fell outside the association's purview. The NCAA's findings were based on a Penn State commissioned investigation led by the former FBI Director Louis J. Free. Several penalties were later rescinded, partly because private emails that were released later as part of a lawsuit suggested that the NCAA had strong-armed the university into accepting the punishments. The lesson learned here, said Gabe Feldman, director of Tulane University's sports law program, is the NCAA needs to strictly follow its own rules, and making exceptions for exceptionally bad or criminal conduct can lead to problems. The Michigan State case also seems to rely on several tactics and reasonings that are atypical for the NCAA. It is unclear how much the organization will be able to rely on a university-commissioned investigation by the former United States Attorney Patrick Fitzgerald, which has so far exonerated Michigan State officials. Josephine R. Potuto, a law professor and faculty athletics representative at the University of Nebraska who has served on the NCAA's Committee on Infractions, said that while Dr. Nassar's actions were far worse morally than, say, an agent paying a college player under the table, the latter was more obviously grist for the NCAA. The question, she said of Dr. Nassar's actions, is whether that should come under NCAA authority. A committee on infractions affirmed this technical view of NCAA enforcement several months ago when it concluded that scores of University of North Carolina classes disproportionately attended by athletes were most likely fraudulent but did not violate NCAA bylaws because it was a university-wide problem. But others made the argument that the NCAA should be involved in crimes as serious as Dr. Nassar's if you read their own rules and what their mission statement is. It's about the development of student athletes, said Kathy Redmond, who runs the National Coalition Against Violent Athletes. You can't have people like Nassar hurting student athletes on campus and not have the NCAA step in. In a brief phone interview Tuesday night, Donald M. Remy, the N.C.A.A.'s chief legal officer, acknowledged that he was aware of the context in which observers would view this latest action. "We are always mindful of the voices around college athletics, and we strive to do the right thing," he said. Several observers intimately familiar with the N.C.A.A.'s infractions process said that, in several important respects, there was more meat to the N.C.A.A.'s initial interest in Michigan State than there was years ago with the Penn State case. At least three women, a softball player, gymnast, and a runner, said Dr. Nasser abused them while they were members of Michigan State teams. A former Michigan State rower said school officials twice ignored her complaints about Dr. Nasser, who was a team physician to two female varsity squads. A former gymnastics coach has been accused of seeking to cover up allegations against Dr. Nasser. In contrast, none of Mr. Sandusky's known victims were college football players. "It pulls it closer to campus control," said Tom Yeager, the former Colonial Athletic Association commissioner who once served on the Committee on Infractions. "These are your student athletes." In a letter to Michigan State, which the university released Wednesday morning, the NCAA cited as grounds for the inquiry the principle inscribed in the NCAA Constitution that member schools are obliged to safeguard their athletes' well-being. Experts pointed to several unorthodox aspects of the N.C.A.A.'s letter. The article of the NCAA Constitution that is cited, establishing the principle of maintaining athlete well-being, is not a law so much as a guidance, Ms. Potuto said. A similarly themed bylaw the letter mentioned is more of a commitment, she said. Joshua R. Smith, the assistant athletic director for compliance at Eastern Illinois University, said there had been just three major infractions cases over the past several decades that referred to the well-being article. None was remotely like this case. Few would dispute the N.C.A.A.'s characterization of Dr. Nasser's acts as heinous and appalling. But letters of inquiry are typically composed in bloodless prose, experts said. And they are usually signed by a member of the enforcement department, whereas this one was signed by Oliver Luck, an executive vice president who oversees enforcement and several other departments, indicating the high-profile nature of the case. Feldman said large organizations like the NCAA or pro sports leagues often struggle to make the right decision in the eyes of the public. If they punish Penn State, they've overreached. If they don't punish Penn State, they overlooked it, Feldman said. He added, the preferable legacy is to be told you've gone too far in punishing these horrible criminal acts than to be told you haven't gone far enough, as long as there is a good faith basis for punishment in the rules.